Mini chapter 38, Amber with binoculars on Sunset Plaza Drive. Jaymi's first response to seeing Bangdead's new guy score, Hunk or Gross newsfeed, was to start creating Shigem's code out of thin air, beginning with nothing but a fore-echo of this beast's warm, true effusiveness. If the ones and zeros behave themselves, Shigem will soon emerge from his code. He'll be painted with his own visuals, which will animate him. He'll be scored with his own soundtrack, which will come alive, and then he'll be tested. Then, within a few days, he'll be electrified into incarnated form, in all his beauty, like a burst of love. But despite this creation cycle of Shigem, there is little clarity as to how the guy score, Hunk or Gross newsfeed, could possibly fail to barrel upwards and outwards in popularity and profitability around the world, at least for as long as tabloid culture outsells the rest. There can be no assurance of the success of any investment, but a media stream that facilitates the rating of individual men for attractiveness using Ain't They Freaky's Freakometer, from a highest score of 10 for Hunkist down to a lowest score of 1 for Grossist by members of the public, does at least start out with the benefit of appealing to the resources of a decent majority. Incarnated into the world by themselves, Jaymi's bursts of Shigem love would stand no chance against such competition. But with a little backup, perhaps they might survive after all. Perhaps Amber's attentiveness to Dud should be ramped up a notch. Perhaps Amber has been neglecting Dud in the last day or two. Yes, it's true. Dud is ready for his first home visit. A mere few hours after these musings, Amber is back on Sunset Plaza Drive, coasting the car to a halt beside that flimsy crash barrier once again. He gets out and straightens up with that mild smile of his. Steps around the car and scans the view for a leisurely moment. Then he raises binoculars to his face, points them somewhat downwards off the promontory, and fine-tunes the focus. Dud's home is one of those structures just down there, half hidden behind trees. It's always difficult for a stalker to get an accurate handle on the exact configuration of properties in the Hollywood Hills, so narrow and winding are the streets as they hug the flanks of the canyons and curve around the hill spurs, and so anonymous is the aspect presented to the street by many a home whose multi-storied luxury extends in multi-CCTV cascade down the slopes on its far side, invisible to any outsider who may drive past its modest-looking front door and garage door, however much this interloper may slow down to peer through their windscreen. But Dud's home cannot long elude such scrutiny as Amber's. And yes, there it is, just there, hiding beyond those bits of scrub, about level with the tops of those skinny-trunked trees growing further down. Dud's house is indeed quite close beneath Amber and Jaymi right now, located on the very highest stretch of Blue Jay Way. That street, however, has no accessible connection at all with this one. It may be just a few flaps of the wing for a flying crow, but for a car, or for any member of the public who might be peculiar enough to walk, it would be a long journey down to Blue Jay Way from here, whether choosing to go further up Sunset Plaza Drive or back down it, by way of a labyrinthine layout of residential streets that would be almost impossible to navigate successfully by mapless chance. Amber knows how to drive there, however, and with this very goal in mind, he returns to the car and sets off in the better direction, which is back down the way he came. After many dozens of twists downwards, there comes the secret key. He turns off Sunset Plaza up Rising Glen Road. Further on, he turns up Thrasher Avenue, then in due course he swings the car quietly right off Thrasher, purring into the bottom end of Blue Jay Way in the stillness of early dusk.